300 feet.
Good morning, everybody.
And welcome to St. Matthew's. I'm Ron, one of the associate pastors here, and we are glad that you are worshiping with us this morning. And as we prepare for worship, I invite everybody to stand as they're able to greet one another in God's house.
Thank you.
This morning, I invite you to continue to celebrate our Lord by singing the hymn of praise, which is number 127 in our hymnal, "Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah." We'll be singing all three verses. Months, basically since August, we have kept on our altar or somewhere here in front of the sanctuary this glass box here of our marbles. And each marble represents a week from August, so basically 52 marbles. And it's to serve as a reminder of how faithful we have been this past week, where we have failed, what has gotten in our way to being a dedicated disciple of Christ, and what we can do different next week. It is a time of reflection, as Christians were called to do this. So each week we'll take a marble as a reminder, and we're halfway through. Pray for the coming week to see how God can use you in your gifts and your skills, and how you can be closer to Him.
We are glad you're here with us this morning at St. Matthew's on this your Sabbath day. Thank you for choosing to spend part of your Sunday morning and Sabbath experience with us here at St. Matthew's. I was told that some of us might be watching our phones during the service.
I don't know.
Y'all watch Tim to see if he sees how this lady Bulldogs are doing in the service. Keep your eyeball on Tim to see what happens.
You know the story, you can say it out.
So if we hear random, I got a good story about my ordination involving sports and transistor radios and God's judgment. So we are glad you're with us this morning at St. Matthew's, especially as we gather into the season of Lent. Brian has already reminded us of through our prayer of confession and then through our reminder of the normal promise about God's desire to draw us to himself. As we focus ourselves upon the cross and focus ourselves upon God's redemption and God's love for us, how we are called more and more to love our God and know our God's love. So this morning, as we prepare to seek God's face through prayer, I invite you to join with me as we sing our call to prayer, which will be hymn number 354, Be Still My Soul. We'll do the first and second of this hymn. Yes, life does have with it its troubles and its trials and its strains and its worries. Yes. But you remain God. You remain upon the throne. And no matter how high the wave, or no matter how pressing the storm, or no matter any of these struggles that come our way, we rejoice knowing that you are God. So, Father, to those in the storm now, give them confidence that comes from knowing you remain God. And Father, no matter where we find ourselves today, give us the confidence that comes from knowing you have not and will not leave our side. We rejoice, O God, because you are good and your mercy endures forever. Thank you. Father God, we do now come with many hurts upon our heart, Father, many whom we love, God, who are in need. Father, we pray now in this day for those that are sick. God, those that are battling cancer and so many types of disease and illness, oh God, be with them. Comfort and strengthen them, God. reminded of your all-amazing presence. Father, we come now with many who we love, who battle all manner of issues and problems. Father, we pray for your grace in the midst of the brokenness of life. Father, we come with those upon our heart who are grieving the death of loved ones. Comfort them this time of loneliness and sadness. Father, we come now praying for our nation and for our leaders. Be with them, God, and give them, O Father, your godly discernment and wisdom in all things. Father, we pray as well for our military. Keep them safe in this hour, especially those who are far from home. We pray, O God, for these many. Father, we pray for those for whom no one else prays. Loving God, we now do come to you with confidence because your word tells us as we prayed earlier that you are faithful and just and will forgive us of all sins when we confess. So, Father God, we now come knowing that we have received your forgiveness, Father. Help us to live as forgiven children in all things. And we do, O God, ask you to forgive us even now those sins in our life, that we may know the freedom that comes through Christ Jesus. We love you. We ask this morning, God, not in our name, but we ask in the name of the one who taught us to pray, as we say, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, St. Matthew's on this Sunday morning. Thanks for making us part of your Sabbath and your rest and your recreation. So thank you for being here with us today. There are several announcements we want to highlight to you out of your newsletter. We hope you grab the newsletter on your way in. It's always the best way to keep up with all the important things happening here in St. Matthew's. We'd invite you as well to visit our website throughout the week. Lots of great updates on the website you can always check in with. And also, if you've not done so, download our mobile app for your smartphone. So many different levels and ways for you to be connected to the great things that God's doing here in St. Matthew's throughout the week. A few announcements we want to highlight are, first, during the season of Lent, we are taking up a Lenten offering that goes to benefit Rise Against Hunger. I said it right. I did not say Rise Up Against Hunger. I'm very proud of myself. I always call it the wrong thing. Rise Against Hunger. So we hope that you will contribute to that above and beyond your tithes and offerings. It's a great way that we can help feed thousands. Our church regularly participates in this ministry, and because of you and your dedication and your hard work, we've literally fed thousands of people across God's world. We rejoice in that. So we would encourage you to be part of that. Also, know that next Sunday at 10 o'clock here in the sanctuary, we're going to have an information meeting about our Honduras mission trip. So we would encourage you to be present for that next Sunday. If you want to learn more about our trip, you can also read more about it in your bulletin. Be sure to check out all the great things that our children and youth are doing. Lots of activities for children and youth in the coming days. Be sure to plug in. We'd love to talk to you more about how your child or your youth can be part of the great things happening here at St. Matthew's. So many great things. We hope you'll take a moment and also take out your pew pad and let us know if you're going to be here for Wednesday night for our great Wednesday night live programming for our meal. If you're not part of Wednesday night live, you're missing a real blessing each Wednesday. And if you're a visitor or have new info, we'd love for you to put that down on the pew pad. That way we can connect with you further and help you know the great things happening here at St. Matthew's. At this time, we're going to continue worshiping as we invite our ushers and acolytes forward for our morning offering.
So, Lord, we ask that you just bless these gifts so that your kingdom can grow and your name be glorified through the ministry of this church. We ask all this in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
All right, if I could have the children join me down front, let's squeeze through this opening. All right, we got a little challenge this morning because I can't let you sit behind the tables. So nobody can see you. So, we're all going to fit in this one area. Can y'all do that for me? Come on. Absolutely, you can sit by me. Come in. All right. Everybody, I want you to sit up here because I want them to be able to see you. I mean, I see you easy. Because you're right there. And you're happy. I like that. All right. I'm not going to be that loud. You don't have to put your fingers in your ears. It's a lot. I'll try to talk normal. You're thinking about Reverend Andy.
Yeah.
All right. Okay, have any of you, like, ever had something that you were afraid to do, and your mom and dad kind of gave you encouragement, and they helped you through it? Yeah. You know, I think I know something that we can all relate to. Shots. Who likes to get a shot? Oh my gosh. You know, you would think I was saying who likes cupcakes. Okay, see, that's all they're hearing. That's all they're hearing is cupcakes. But you know, there are things that we have to do that sometimes are scary. And sometimes it's really good, like flu shots. I hate flu shots. You can come take mine from now on. You can come take mine from now on. Okay. But like, I got a story for you. You want to hear my story? Okay. He doesn't want to hear my story. It's fine. I was on a camping trip with my dad a long time ago. I was the size of some of you out here. And it was a hiking trip, which means you got to pack up a backpack and you got to carry all your stuff on your back. It's like going to school with your school backpack, but you never get to take it off.
Even a flu shot.
And then you got to climb. I just jacked him in the face. And then you got to climb up a big old mountain. Then you got to climb up a big old mountain. I don't think it's such a challenge today. I'm feeling uncomfortable. I need encouragement. Then you got to climb up a big old mountain. And I was climbing up a big old mountain with my dad. And all of a sudden, I decided I couldn't do it. And I said, I can't do it. You got to carry me. How many parents have heard that one? You got to carry me. Except I wasn't small like some of you. I was like 8 or 9 years old, and I had a big old backpack on my back. And so my dad gave me some encouragement to help me finish that trip. You know, he gave me some encouragement. He said, okay, Sammy, I can't carry you on my back. But you can sit here and rest a while, and when you're ready, you can come. But just really make sure you watch out for the bears. And as my father used to tell this story, he got about 20 to maybe 25 yards up that mountain, and all of a sudden, past at the speed of light, was this really angry 8-year-old boy. But you know what? He gave me the encouragement, even though I was talking about bears. He gave me the encouragement I needed to do something that I otherwise couldn't have done. Well, you know what? There's somebody in the Bible that got that encouragement too. Yeah, how many of you heard the story of David and Goliath? That's right. And David faced a giant. And you got to think that if he had gone by himself, he would have been afraid. But he knew he wasn't alone. God made him brave. God gave him confidence. God encouraged him to do what he otherwise felt couldn't be done. And you know what? God does that for us too. God helps us through bad times. He helps us through dark times. He helps us through scary times. And that's what I want you to remember when you leave here. Never feel afraid to ask God to give you that encouragement when you feel afraid or you need help. Can y'all do that for me? Excellent. Stop that. All right. I tell you what, who wants to pray for me this morning? Okay. She did raise her hand first. Oh,
Dear God, I love you for our bread and for the fruit we get at this store, so we can have our fruit. Amen.
Amen. A hymn of preparation is number 529, How Firm a Foundation. Join with me as we sing verses 1, 2, and 5.
Showing steadfast love to the thousandth generation of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. For 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. You shall not do any work, you, your son, or your daughter, your male or female slave, your livestock, or the alien resident in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that is in them, but rested the seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and consecrated it. Honor your father and your mother, so that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or male or female slave, or ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
all they do to help lead us in worship. I just love that arrangement of that hymn. So thank you for that, choir. Our next reading will be another Old Testament reading. It's going to come from 1 Samuel chapter 17. We're going to read verses 19 through 50. It's the story of David and Goliath, a story that we've heard many, many, many times. So we're going to pick up about halfway through the story, though, the story of David and Goliath. So we'll be in 1 Samuel chapter 17, and we'll start with verse 39. We'll read through verse 50. 1 Samuel 17, verses 39 through 50. David strapped Saul's sword over the armor. He tried in vain to walk, for he was not used to them. Then David said to Saul, "I cannot walk with these, for I am not used to them." So David removed them. Then he took his staff in his hand and chose five smooth stones from the wadi. He put them in a shepherd's bag and in the pouch. His sling was in his hand. He drew near to the Philistine. Now the Philistine came and drew near to David, with a spear bearer in front of him. When the Philistine looked and saw David, he disdained him, for he was only a youth, ruddy and handsome in appearance. And the Philistine said to David, "Am I a dog that you come to me with sticks?" The Philistine cursed David by the gods. The Philistine said to David, "Come to me, and I will give your flesh to the birds of the air and to the wild animals of the field." But David said to the Philistine, "You come to me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This very day the Lord will deliver you into my hand, and I will strike you down and cut off your head, and I will give the dead bodies of the Philistine army this very day to the birds of the air, to the wild animals of the earth, so that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel, that all this assembly may know that the Lord does not save by sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's. He will give you into our hand." When the Philistine drew near to meet David, David ran quickly toward the battle line to meet the Philistine. David put his hand in his bag, took out a stone and slung it, and struck the Philistine in his forehead. The stone sank into his forehead and he fell down on the ground. So David prevailed over the Philistine with a stone and a sling, striking down the Philistine and killing him. There was no sword in David's hand. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. There are certain biblical or spiritual concepts that, in many ways, transcend the church, that have just become woven into the fabric of our secular society. Certain concepts, certain images, certain things that really started out in the church and were part of our Christian and religious experience, but have in many ways escaped that and become part of just the culture we live, and to the fact that everyone knows what they are and everyone knows what they mean, even if they don't necessarily know the spiritual or Christian meaning behind them. The cross is kind of like that. The cross has become a sign for many of peace and comfort and warmth and acceptance and love, in many ways almost disconnected from the spiritual meaning behind it in the church. It's just become an issue, an image of peacefulness. Google peace on your Google machines and you'll find a cross. It's just going to pop up as something that we associate with peace. Same thing with going to that with Judas and the betrayal. Think about how many times in pop culture you've heard about someone being betrayed with a kiss. We think of Judas and betrayal even beyond the connections of Christianity. Think of Amazing Grace. How many times you've heard Amazing Grace played in a public setting, in a memorial service. There really wasn't even a religious experience, but Amazing Grace has become, in many ways, our national hymn. I read a great article recently, a great book rather, about that, about how Amazing Grace has become kind of the national hymn of America, almost detached from the Christian meaning behind it. It's just become part of our national fabric. And the story of David and Goliath, that's another one. That's something that has just become part of our conversation. You don't believe me? Pay attention next month in March Madness. Now, my team won't be playing it. Maybe hopefully yours will be. But any time the next month, a lower seed defeats a higher seed, you're going to hear the phrase Cinderella invoked. And you're going to hear the phrase, well, David just beat Goliath. Anytime in our society, if it's in sports, you see it in business. Anytime the smaller company outraises or outworks the larger company, David has beaten Goliath. Anytime a smaller entity defeats the larger entity, David has defeated Goliath. That's just kind of a concept and a phrase that has gone beyond even the church. It's just part of our national cultural fabric. David and Goliath. So today we read from David and Goliath. And boy, as a preacher, man, that's an all-you-can-eat buffet right there. There's about 1,000 sermons you can preach on David and Goliath. So many things there that are so impactful to our faith. I love in David and Goliath, how when David first comes to Saul, we saw the very end of that in this passage. How Saul tells David, put on my armor, because you're a shepherd. And a shepherd can't defeat Goliath. Here, put on my armor. So David puts on Saul's armor and puts on Saul's sword and has all the royal regalia of his armor. And it's too clunky for David to wear. So David takes off all the armor and goes to war with Goliath, dressed in his shepherd's outfit. We can't defeat Goliath being somebody we're not. How long in our life have we tried to be somebody we're not? Be who God created you to be and live according to God's word. Don't try to be somebody you're not. David couldn't defeat Goliath until he was truly the person God made him and created him to be. We see that. We see the great motivation in this story. If you stand with courage, I come to you not with sword, but I come in the name of the Lord. And the Lord will win this battle, and the Philistines will be killed. And we will be victorious, not because of our strength, but because of God. Such great motivation to be strong, like Sammy said this morning. To be courageous, to have motivation, to do the right thing. So many great motivating stories there in David and Goliath. Such a powerful story of God's provision. There's a great acronym for studying the scripture that you may or may not be familiar with called SOAP. S-O-A-P. It's a great way to study scripture. S, starting off with scripture itself. O, observation. What do you see there? What do you see within the text? What speaks to you? Application. Where can you apply it to your life? P, prayer. S-O-A-P. Scripture, observation, application, prayer. There are so many powerful things to observe in the story of David and Goliath. There are so many powerful things that we can apply to our life. I'm going to read this story. Such a powerful story of God's provision and God's protection and God's empowerment. Great story. One of the best in all the Bible. One of the ones that we all know. Scripture's interesting. During the season of Lent that we're in right now, we're going to be looking at some interesting passages of Scripture. Last week, I'm blessed to serve alongside some amazing pastors here at St. Matthew's. Brian and Aaron do such a great job. Lads, if you're part of our Rooted in Christ Bible study, if you're not, I would encourage you to be part of it. Last week, Brian wrote the reading guides that we studied throughout the week. This week, Aaron will study those reading guides. So I'm so blessed to serve alongside some amazing pastors. But last week, we started this series where we're looking at the Old Testament. And seeing Christ there. Last week we looked at David and Nathan. We're like, ooh, where do you find Jesus in the midst of that? When Nathan calls out David, where do you find Jesus in the midst of someone being called out for sin? See, because we make a mistake with Scripture sometimes. You know how when you're watching TV, I don't know if you're like me, you want to fast forward to the good parts. Like you're watching a DVD, I'll fast forward through all the talking and get things blowing up. It's kind of how I am when I watch a movie. I want to get to the good parts first. We do that with God's Word. We want to fast forward through the Old Testament sometimes, don't we? And get to the good part. Get to the Gospels. Get to the New Testament. Get to the part that makes sense. We want to hit fast forward and get through the Old Testament part. Get to the part that we like and that makes sense to us. But here's the thing with that. We make mistakes sometimes with how we approach Scripture. Really, how we approach God. Because I don't know that we do it consciously, but sometimes we look at Scripture like this. Well, you know, it all started out in the garden. It was great. It was all great. You know, the garden was wonderful. And then we ate the fruit. It all spun downhill from there. And then God's like, man, what am I going to do? They messed up. What am I going to do? Well, okay. I'll send Abraham. And that'll fix it. Well, then Abraham didn't work. What am I going to do? Abraham didn't work. Okay, I'll send Moses. That's what I'll do. I'll send Moses, and Moses will fix it. Well, then Moses didn't work. God's in heaven going, what am I going to do? Moses didn't work. I'll send David. David will fix it, and that'll be okay. And then David didn't fix it. And then the Lord's like, David didn't fix it. Okay, I'll do the prophets, and that'll fix it. And then that didn't fix it. And then God's in heaven going, I guess I better send Jesus. Nothing else worked. What we've done is we have made Jesus God's plan B. Like, when nothing else worked, I guess I'll send Jesus. Instead of understanding that Scripture teaches us that Jesus Christ was the Lamb that was slain before the foundations of the world. Jesus was not God's plan B. Jesus was God's plan the entire time. So the Old Testament is full of example after example after example about how God is making the way for Jesus to come and save us. Jesus is not God's plan B. Jesus was God's plan the entire time. All of this book is infused with Jesus Christ. All of this book points to Jesus Christ. We see it in the Ten Commandments today. How God will show mercy. How, as much as we focus on the stuff of the law, the last commandment said you shouldn't covet. Coveting is internal. You can't tell if I'm coveting or not. No, it'll show itself in my actions, but coveting is internal. Even there, all throughout the Old Testament, we see so many things pointing to Jesus. It's all pointing to Jesus. So then, what do we do with David and Goliath? Where do we see Jesus in this story? Well, this is how we usually read David and Goliath. You know, I'm afraid. I hear these Ten Commandments, and I can't keep them. And, you know, I know that I'm David. And, man, God's going to give me the power in my life, and God's going to give me the strength, and I'm David, and I'm going to get this, and I'm going to take my 5 stones, and I'm going to slay the Goliath in my life. That's what I'm going to do. I'm David, and I'm going to slay Goliath. But more often than not, Goliath defeats me. A lot of times, most of the time, I get it wrong. I fail, I sin, I don't do it right, I struggle. And so then I feel like I'm a bad Christian because I'm not getting it right. And surely, if I'm a Christian, I can defeat Goliath, right? Isn't that what the Bible says? That I can do this. So if I can't do it, then I must be doing something wrong. If I keep messing up, I must be doing something wrong. Right? That's what it's got to mean. I'm going to make a suggestion to you this morning. I want to offer you a different way of looking at David and Goliath. We understand that Goliath is our enemy. The enemy to our souls. The devil. The things that we fight against. The things that we struggle against. We understand that. That makes sense. But what I want to suggest to you is this. Maybe we're not David. Maybe we are the helpless Israelites in need of a Redeemer. Maybe we are the helpless Israelites Jesus Christ is David. Jesus Christ is the one who defeats the enemy. Jesus Christ is the one who defeats our Goliath. He is the one that redeems us and saves us. So instead of us trying to fight the battle that we keep losing, instead of us trying to slay the giant that keeps beating us, instead of us butting our head against temptations and struggles and sickness and hatred and sin, we need to understand that the battle is not for us to fight. The battle is for us to surrender to our Savior who will fight the battle for us. The enemy is not our enemy to slay. The enemy is God's enemy to slay. And through the power of the cross and resurrection, the enemy has already been defeated.
Amen.
That death has already been overcome, and that salvation has come. And so we get so frustrated because in our minds, we're David trying to fight Goliath, and we lose a lot. Instead of realizing that we already have a Redeemer, we already have a Savior, we already have someone who has slain Goliath, and that someone is Jesus Christ. So that temptation you're fighting, perhaps you're fighting it wrong. Perhaps it's instead of trying to get motivated and fired up to go do it, we need to give it to Jesus. That Goliath that keeps whooping you, that illness, that fear, that doubt, that thing that wells up deep in your soul, that fear that keeps welling up deep in your soul that you can't contain, and that seems to overwhelm you. And as much as you try, and as hard as you try, and as much as you try to do right, it keeps coming back. Maybe the battle is not yours to fight. Maybe you're not David. Maybe I'm not David. Maybe I'm the Israelites in need of a Redeemer. Friends, we have a Redeemer. And his name is Jesus. The battle we fight is a battle of surrender. Laying it at the feet of the Son of David, Jesus the Christ. Laying it down before him. And if you're like me, you take your battles, you lay it down at Jesus' feet, and 5 minutes later, you picked it up again. So you know what you do? You lay it back down. And when you pick it up again, you lay it back down. When you pick it up again, you lay it back down. We want to be sanctified like this, don't we? We want to just give it to Jesus and be done with it. Okay, done with that. Moving on. Moving on. But we still feel the breath of Goliath breathing down our neck. That's why each day, each moment, each hour, each minute, we lay it down at Jesus' feet over and over and over and over, knowing that he is the Son of David. He is the perfect David. He is the Redeemer of our souls. And the battle is not ours to fight. The battle is his to fight. And he has already overcome. Our job is to lay that fight at his feet. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Friends, we have a Redeemer who has already defeated Goliath. And his name is Jesus. May we give him all of our fights. And may we know that he will be victorious. And greater is he who's in us than he who is in the world. May we live in the power of Jesus' redemption. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for the power of Jesus, for the power of resurrection, for the power of hope. May we live according to your power, according to your grace, and according to your hope in all things. We love you. We ask this in Jesus' sweet and holy name. Amen. This morning, during our closing song of invitation, the altar's open. Perhaps there's a Goliath that you're tired of fighting, that you have just been fighting forever, and he has been wearing you out. And you're tired of fighting. Today's the day to give to Jesus. Today's the day to give to Jesus. Perhaps you've never accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Perhaps you've been going through the motions of religion, but you've never truly taken Christ as Lord. Today is the day to do that. Perhaps you just need to come pray. Brian or I would love to pray with you this morning. But this morning, no matter where you find yourself, the altar is open, and Jesus Christ stands here ready. Won't you come?